Hello out there in the realms of the living. Welcome to Thrones of Game, the only podcast brave enough to watch Game of Thrones backwards. I'm your host, BT Calloway. I've watched the series from beginning to end, but joining me is the man, the only man on this earth who has watched Game of Thrones backwards, Elliot Jay O'Neill. How are you doing, buddy?
Well, actually,
we don't have time. How many times will you catch up to this? A fast podcast is a good podcast. Let's get straight stuck into this one. This is Season 8, Episode 2, A Knight of Seven Kingdoms. What did you think?
This was the second episode of the season?
Yeah.
And they're already spinning the wheels.
Well, this is all, again, this is the downside of, the only downside of going backwards is that the pacing is a bit fucked. So naturally, this is all the hype and the tension and the preparing for the battle that we saw last time. All the preparations for, which is not the most thrilling thing when you already know who lives and who dies.
No, and I will say, I think there were better moments in this one than certainly the last episode I reviewed, which we just fucking gouged.
Man, it's a tough one to love. I want to love it, that's the hard part, but
Well, even in this episode where it felt like they were spinning the wheels, there was way more, artistic contrast and good cinematography. Even in scenes that were, in mostly grayscale, the chat between Arya and the weapons maker, I thought, yeah, that's a scene with muted colors that still looked dynamic.
Yeah, and they managed to, position them and get the blocking. It looked interesting. The framing and everything looked interesting and good. That was Gendry Baratheon, obviously.
Yeah. So is he the one that, wants to whisk her away in that other episode?
Yeah, the other one when he's given... he's made Lord of Storm's End, which is, again, ball of name.
Oh, right. Yep.
Is all like, hey, how about you marry me? Because I don't know what I'm doing.
Yep, the bastard and the twat.
That's the one.
Yeah.
Yep. So, all right.
I enjoyed parts of this a lot better, but yeah, I think you're right. This is probably more on me for not watching the show right, but...
No. There's no wrong way to enjoy something. This is the point. We can dig into what happened, but really, we kind of just covered it. This is all the preparing for The Long Night, the episode that comes after this.
Yeah.
You get some characters reunite. Jaime Lannister. It starts with Jaime Lannister showing up in Winterfell and everyone being like, eh, how about this guy? Okay, we'll keep him. Mm. Starts off with Dan Brady going, they told me a bedtime story about the man who murdered my father and the horrible things we would do. We would peel his skin off and eat it like bacon.
That was my the first big laugh of this, because my brother used to tell me a bedtime story, and I'm like, oh, that's nice.
That's lovely.
About the man who murdered my father. Oh, and the many things we'd fucking do to his stupid corpse. Oh.
Yeah. It's going to be a long time to meet him, but her brother's a dick.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah.
Is he the one that
I'll
is...
I'll never tell.
Okay, the father of Snowy?
No. Not John Bond, Snowy's real father.
That was a complicated fucking web of craziness going on where...
Web of intrigue.
His name is Aegon Targaryen, apparently.
Yep, Aegon Targaryen.
I'd order one of those for breakfast. and his mother is Rhaegon?
Rhaegar.
Rhaegar, okay.
And his mother is Lyanna. I can never remember.
Oh, his dad is Rhaegon.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Rhaegon Targaryen. Rhaegon target practice.
Yeah, so I had no fucking basis for what the hell was going on in that last scene. She looked shocked, though.
Yeah, no, this, again, was building for a long, long time, and it's something we only found out end of the season before this one, which we'll get to in two episodes' time.
Ah.
Yeah, which is the old R plus L equals J, so that theory ended up being correct. The fans figured this one out a long time beforehand.
Oh, is that right?
Mm-hmm, book fans, mostly, because, they were all, snarky wankers, because, books.
Yeah. Yeah, I heard that was a thing of all the book wankers going on the Reddit threads for the show and actually in the books.
Actually, in the books.
Yeah, in the books, Dumbledore kills Snape.
Yeah, what I really want to do is start trolling people who didn't this season by just going, well, if you read the books, you would know. But it's not out yet. Shut up. Go to the future and read the books.
You haven't read the books yet, obviously. You have to know George R. R. Martin. He'll fax you a copy. You've got to have a fax.
He only faxes.
Why it takes him so long to release the books, because faxing...
Apparently part of it is he works on a very, very old word processing program, because it, amongst other things, he just likes it, but amongst other things, it doesn't have autocorrect. So when you're naming things like Targaryen and Rhaegar and all these other, fantasy words, that would be a lot of things in spell check.
Yeah. No, I got to say, I get frustrated on it because so many, like, you know, we run the Simpsons Index, not the podcast, and so many of the episode titles are just fucking puns. And so, yeah, I'm constantly like, no, add that fucking stupid word to the dictionary.
Yep. All right. Well, moving on. MVP, which actor or scene or moment really was the best part of this episode?
Three-time carryover champ.
Tyrion Lannister!
No, honestly, my favorite scenes of the episode, he was driving once again. Mm-hmm. Like, and like him sort of running with this whole all is lost thing. Yeah. And let's just try and be drunk and merry on our last days. Like, there was a sort of dourness to the characters for the rest of the episode. Like, Arya came close, but I thought they didn't give her enough to do.
Yeah, yeah, she's kind of just walking around being still kind of mysterious.
Yeah.
And
although, you know, honorable mention to the littlest giant killer, who, yeah, stood in defiance, but they kind of had that episode twice because there was another kid asking for supers. Where should I go, me lord?
And yeah, that was, instead of saying, can I have some more, please?
Yeah.
She was like, where should I go? I'd like to be a warrior, thank you.
And they do that thing where, yeah, you lie to the kid. We've got a very important job for you to
do. We need you to guard the car. You know, that whole deal. Yeah, I'm not quite sure why that scene is there. Like, they're just trying to comfort the children. But they're not trying to comfort the children in the face of almost certain oblivion, which is what they should be doing. I don't know. It's not like it's badly acted or badly directed, and all the characters seem sweet, but I'm just not quite sure why it's there. What function do you perform, this scene?
Yeah, and especially because they have it essentially twice with, yeah, littlest giant killer later, standing in defiance and going, I'm going to go fuck shit up. I'm going to slay a giant.
Well, she's always been like that. This would, of course, be Bear Island Girl, whose name I refuse to look up.
That's my MO, man. I like, you know, that's how I'm operating.
Yeah, exactly. That's what we're doing here.
Just making up names for characters we don't want to look up.
Absolutely. I mean, I got a few nominees for MVP. I think it's really going to come down to, though, everyone just hanging out by the fire and drinking in that one last moment where they've got Tyrion, Jaime, Brienne, Podrick, Tormund, and Ser Davos all just chilling out, drinking, swapping stories. There's a great moment where I'm sorry, I've pronounced their name wrong, where they knight
Tilda Swanson.
Tilda Swanson, there it was.
Yep. Well, yeah, Jaime does a lot for her. He deflowers her, he knights her. Wonder what else their relationship has to offer.
Yes.
Well, actually, they alluded at it earlier. She was like, what the fuck's wrong with you? You're not insulting me right now.
Yeah, no, that's the other thing I really like about this episode is all our buddy cop movies come back together in this one. So throughout previous seasons, pairs of characters have gone together, wandered length and breadth of the land for various reasons. So, but here they're all meeting up again. We've got Arya and the Hound. We've got Podrick and Brienne. We've got Brienne and Jaime. All these people who have spent time just hanging out together, reunited. It's adorable.
Yeah. And the scene of, yeah, drinking around the fire was, yeah, all four of those were my three favorite scenes of the episode.
Yeah, like, and who knew Podrick could sing? That dude's got some pipes.
Oh, he was hiding that talent?
Yeah, I don't think it's ever come up before.
Oh, so, I mean, the way he sung, he, like, struck me as that guy that was, like, always, like, would you like me to sing? Come on.
Oh, I guess. Also, being the Jenna Maroney of this series.
Yeah, exactly. I believe the children are our future.
No, he's never brought that up before. And I kind of wish this was the fade-out for the episode, to have this kind of sweet but also a little bit sad song panning. And they're panning over all the families and people who meant something to each other and then panned out to the White Walkers as they arrived. I think that would have been, because that's everything you're risking. That's, you know, this big show of, you know, these are all these people who are happy and warm and safe, and but for how much longer?
Yeah, it's almost like they broke it up just to have a different version of it in the credits, which, like, yeah, I think I agree with you. It was less effective than if it was like, because it was just like a verse and a chorus.
Yeah, it wasn't incredibly complicated.
Yeah, they could have had, yeah, another verse and chorus go over that. Yeah, I agree.
Yep, but we had to get the whole RNL equals J thing out of there.
Yes.
Yes, yes. Yeah, again, same scene where they're all just sitting around. I do like the women can't be nice, just, why not? Tradition. Fuck tradition! Which is a pretty good slogan, fuck tradition.
Yeah.
There's a good quote floating around the internet, which is, tradition is just peer pressure from ghosts. So, fuck you ghosts, and fuck most traditions.
I like that. Because especially, like, I really wasn't enjoying Creepy Uncle Man at the start, where he was just sort of, like, leering over Tilda.
Tormund Giantsbane.
Mm.
Yeah.
And then, yeah, his whole story about sucking a giant's tit after killing a giant husband.
For 3 months as well. You got to keep that farce up, where she's like, you know, thinks that's her baby. It's like, but you'd have to, like, go home and do about your normal stuff and then go back and pretend to be a baby again. That's weird.
Probably. With a beard.
Yeah. Well, he said he was 10. So probably just stubble at that point.
Oh, he said he was 10, right.
Yeah, when he killed his first giant.
Right. And was he drinking giant's milk in that moment? Because there was a certain creaminess coming out of the horn.
Maybe it was like a, you know, like a Kilkenny or a Guinness or something.
Oh, right. Yep. And then, yeah, classic. Oh, I guess I will have that drink after all.
Sir Davos. I'm just saying, he rocks. He's still possibly my favorite character in the whole show.
Yep. But again, you know, sitcom at break music after that moment.
Yeah, that was the other bit. When we've got the whole, you know, little kid like, I'll defend the crypt then. And we're like, we know what happens to the crypt.
Yeah.
You probably did.
Again, one of these like post-foreshadowing things that we keep running into. Oh, yeah. Everything's safe in the crypt. You know, you should go down the crypt where everything's safe.
Everything is safe in the crypt.
Oh, yeah. Dead people resurrecting.
What I kind of call almost backshadowing. Or is backshadowing when we reference something now that's going to happen earlier in the show? I don't know.
Uh-huh.
Look, we're forging new ground here, man. We're going to have to figure out what backshadowing refers to.
Foreshadowing new ground.
Yep.
Yeah.
Hey, it's also a very memeable episode. Sorry, I want to get this out before I forgot it again because I forgot earlier. Because we got this scene between Sansa and Dan Brady where Dan Brady gives this kind of is it face, though, that's been popping up in memes all over the place.
Oh, really?
Yeah. And also Tormund Giantsbane, when he says, is the tall woman still here? Got memed pretty well. So,
No, they're good quotes.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay. The knighting scene itself, like, that was one where it sort of started out, you know, come over, Neil. I was like, this is... But then I ended up, like, really liking that scene, and I thought they sold the emotion of that quite well.
Yeah, because Tilda Swinton absolutely sells it. And again, I'm really appreciating her as an actor in this rewatch.
Yeah.
Kind of wondering where we're going to see her in other things, because she is very tall.
Yeah.
So not a lot of roles require a gigantic woman, but we'll see.
Yeah, definitely keeping an eye out, because I thought in that moment as well she was going to, like, go fuck off as well, because it's Neil over here, kind of a demeaning thing, but, like... Then when she sold, like, how much it did actually mean to her, that felt good, yeah.
Yeah, because for a moment she was like, oh, yeah, as if I care. And then you know that she does from the bits of the series. And then, yeah, it's a really nice scene. Very simple. Well put together, yeah.
They sell the moment and then everybody cheering, oh, Brienne, the knight, Sir Brienne, and all that. Yeah.
And then you get that just double downs on the betrayal later when Jaime fucks off. So,
oh, yeah.
Yeah, brutal move there, Jaime. Jeez. All right, next question, nudity.
Oh, we got some side boob and some butt.
I know, finally.
Now, Maisie Williams was like 15 or something when she started the show, right?
I think she was 13 when the show started, but she was 21 or 22 when this scene happened.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was a little weird having watched the series beginning to the end go, wait, time, a lot of it has passed.
Yeah. Yeah, it's like that, you know... When you had creepy friends that were like, yay, the Olsen twins are 18, you're like, what?
Yeah, a little bit. But no, I think the scene is actually really well done. It's tastefully shot, and it makes sense for the character.
Mm.
Like, I know you haven't got a lot of background experience with it, but a lot of her character arc is murder. So to have a little tender nails.
Well, no, I mean, I got her penchant for killing when, you know, on her incredible accuracy in throwing knives and archery.
Yep.
And, yeah, also the multiple scars that they...
Yeah,
kind of
like when she first takes her top off, the first thing you see is these big, dirty scars. And you're like, oh, that's right.
Yeah. And they took the time, you know. those characters wear a lot of layers, and there's so much untying going on.
And it's very unromantic, but that's the way it is, folks. Here's some hard reality for you.
Okay, got to untie my leather shawl and my leather shoulder pads and my leather corset.
And these freaking stitches just take forever. You have to be sewn into this, otherwise it falls apart.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And artistically, I thought when they sort of cut back to her briefly post-coitus, she kind of looked a little, whatever.
No, I think just the grim reality of tomorrow was weighing heavily on her.
Oh, right,
was the
right.
idea.
But, yeah.
It was a little weird in this episode to have so many people going, oh, we're all going to die tomorrow. We're totally fucked tomorrow. Oh, we're definitely going to die tomorrow. So many of them don't.
Yeah.
So.
No, episode 2 as well, like... I don't know, maybe this was sort of hype for the season to come. But yeah, this feels like such a mid-season episode to me.
Like, yeah, fair, fair. But again, it's a mid-season of the final season, and we've been waiting for this part for a very long time.
Yeah, yeah.
In proper chronological order.
But yeah, after watching this as well, like, it does like make me wonder like how really like unsatisfying the war must have been for a lot of people, because they really did build this up as like a very unwinnable fight, and they've got this specific strategy about, you know, Bran sort of luring him, and like good fighters are sort of like being close but not too close and all that sort of shit. And there's a lot of clever planning that I don't think got paid off.
Again, we see trebuchets, they use them once.
Yeah.
God damn.
They're even practicing it.
Yeah, and there's like a good bit, you know, they're looking at the field. There's a great bit where they have the war map and they've got, you know, their armies and then just all these blue tiles that are just the horde in front of them.
Yeah.
And yeah, that's an intimidating moment and it feels serious. And I wish this season had been longer so they could have had maybe Winterfell falls and they have to fall back and fight in a new position or something. I would have been very interesting and very dramatic to actually have a loss on their hands.
Yeah.
But no.
Well, I mean, it could have even, yeah, stretched that battle against the White Walkers for, yeah, two episodes maybe, and like, and also, you know, directed it good.
Yep, there's a lot of problems, but hey, what we got is here, so that's what we're working with.
Yep.
Next question, violence. I don't think there was any.
Just training violence.
Just training montage violence. There's a bit of...
One dude did the whole, oh, the sword's in my armpit, I didn't really get stabbed thing.
Did he? I didn't see that.
Yeah, when like Tilda and Jamie are like watching the people practice.
Oh, yeah. That's Podrick, again, who's teaching swordplay. He's come a long way, that Podrick.
Oh, wow.
Yep.
He's full of surprises, that boy.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely. Survives the whole thing, ends up being Kingsguard and just wheeling Bran around. That's a good life. He's happy, I think.
Yeah.
This is what kind of thing I noticed on this watch through is a lot of, you know, a lot of people are unhappy with the overall story, but if you focus on the individual character stories, a lot of them are very satisfying arcs. I was thinking if you watch this whole thing but just focus on Sansa's arc, that is a ride.
Yeah.
And I think she ends up very in a very good place and works out quite well in a horrific way to get there, but hey.
Yeah, well, I mean, I haven't really seen much of her, like, to be honest. Like,
yeah, no, you'll get there.
Yeah. But, yeah, just going off the last few episodes, like, is her arc that satisfying? Because it sort of, from memory, just sort of peters out.
It sort of peters out, but, again, if you focus on it and what it meant, I suppose.
Yeah.
So, you know, the ending for her is she ends up being Queen of the North. That's pretty dope.
Yeah, not bad.
Yep.
Good promotion.
Yeah, exactly. Couple of random bits and pieces. I'll just dig through that now. Girls who throw knives are hot. Just gonna say that. Anyone out there wondering how you can up your sexy? Forget the gym. Start throwing knives. Missandei, I'm probably pronouncing that wrong, is all like, when this is over, how about we go to Narth? And that's where Grey Worm, aka the only black man in Westeros, goes at the end.
Was his accent different in this episode?
I don't think so. He's always very short and quick with his words.
Yeah, I guess maybe he was talking with a lot more aggression in the episodes that I've seen.
I think maybe he's just had more words.
Yeah.
He's, again, usually very shortly spoken. Mm. Oh, yeah. Gents, make your lady a custom weapon. She'll love it.
Yes. It's another one of these things where it's like, okay, you're giving the great warrior, as they might be, a weapon that they've clearly never trained with. Like,
to be fair, she has trained with the staff before.
Oh, okay.
But you've not seen that. But hey, again, this is what we're in. Yeah, backshadowing, if that's what that is. Bird internet. Yeah, I think the kind of the trouble with this one, not terribly much happens because they're all about fortifying the location they're in. I mean, sure, there's some big revelations in terms of John tells Dan Brady, you know, his actual heritage and all that. But in terms of, yeah, scenes and things like that, there's not terribly much going on. But again, that's the point.
Yeah.
You don't want to build something new in the middle of all this. Though I was just thinking, it would have been amazing if he was all like, by the way, I'm Rhaegon Targaryen's son and I have a claim to the throne. And she was like, stab. That would have been interesting.
Yeah. Because, like, I mean, people were sort of, like, wondering if Snowy was going to die in this whole thing, eh?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's always been a question. It's always a question who's going to die next, but...
Yeah. Game of Thrones.
Yep. Who's going to die next?
Barney Rubble thought he'd die with a belly full of wine with a girl's mouth around his cock.
Yep. I do like that Jamie finishes that for him. He's like, yeah, I know you've said this. This is like a catchphrase.
You said it at the speech at my birthday party.
It's how you walk into a room now. It's, you know.
I wrote something about Bran with the three-eyed raven, but I don't know if...
Yeah, he's all, well, there's this whole... You find out in this one that Jamie once pushed him out of a window, and that's why he's in a wheelchair.
Oh, right, right.
Yeah, yeah.
But so, ever since then, he, like, got magical powers?
Long story, as he says, and I do like the bit where it's like, it's a long story, and Tyrion's like, oh, yeah, well, if only we were in a castle with nothing to do, and it was cold outside, and I had a shit ton of time.
Creaky chair, pour a wine.
It was a good bit, yeah.
Yeah.
And he's got this whole, you know, Jamie's all, you're not mad? And he's like, I'm not really mad at anything anymore. I'm sort of ethereal. Maybe I'm just high.
Mm.
There's a lot of question as to what exactly he is now, so.
Okay. Once again, Samwise just doesn't look like he belongs. And I liked the bit where he's, like, giving the claymore over, and, like, I just wanted to imagine that, so I was like, oh, thanks. I'll use it every day.
But he does.
He does?
He does. He's defending Dan Brady with it at the end.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's a bloody big sword.
It is. Like, claymores are massive.
Yeah. I was just like, you know, I appreciate the gesture. It's just a little too heavy. And
I like what you're saying. I really do. It's just, we're about to go into battle. I don't have time to train with a new weapon. I'm going to use what I have. Thank you very much, but I might re-gift this.
Now go on, wander back over to the film set that you came from. And
although I did think you'd enjoy when they're ripping on him for that, when they're all like,
yeah,
you can go down to the crypt, you know, and he's like, I've killed a White Walker, I've killed a bunch of stuff, I've fought in plenty of battles, I do all the things, like, yeah, whatever, pussy.
Yeah.
He's like, I do like the line of, Samwell Tarly, killer of White Walkers, lover of women, that's a sign of the apocalypse.
Yeah. And the White Walkers riding the horses, they better get that job finished soon, because those things disappear when daytime comes around. And don't try to check them into the stables.
No, they freak out. Breath of the Wild forever. Oh, yeah.
Can't wait for that sequel.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm out of notes.
Yeah, me too, man. I think my last one really is, I think it's interesting, considering where Dan Brady goes in the rest of this season, that when she finds out someone else has a better claim to the throne who's actually part of her family, she isn't like, oh, well, you do it then.
Yeah.
She's like, no, has to be me. It's like, well, why? Wasn't your plan to get your family back on the throne? Does it really matter if it's you, you tyrant?
Yeah, she's just obsessed with the throne, and she will do anything to win that game of it.
Mm, it's a dangerous game, but someone's got to win.
I'm actually surprised in this how, like, they dance around. Like, they can't dance around the word throne.
No.
That's just what it's called. But it's like, we will win this war for the throne. There will be a battle, and the winner will have the throne. It is what you might call a challenge.
It's sort of like musical chairs. It's a game, and there are chairs, but the chairs are thrones.
Mm.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure they do name drop the season series way back in, like, season one.
Yeah.
So, who knows? Can't remember.
Can't wait for that, the roll credits moment.
Yeah. That would be an interesting series. All right, well, if you're done and I'm done, final question, how did we get here?
Well, in the last...
You were operating with the theory that someone had just dissed the Ice Walker, the Night's King, talked about smack about his mama.
Yeah.
You still going with that?
Well, yeah, technically that still could be true.
It very much could be.
Like, they're clearly spinning the wheels, they've gotten the word that war is a-coming, war is afoot, and... Yeah, I think that's it. We just saw the preparations of the great don't talk about my mama like that.
Yeah, you know what? Mothers come up a lot in this, and there's a whole you know, revelation of who John von Snowy's real mother is.
Mm.
So you know, maybe just talking smack about mamas is how we got here.
Yeah. So I'm sticking with that theory.
All right. No, I like it. It's solid. It's good. Let's see what happens when we come back and review the first episode of this season, and then we finally go through a whole season.
Yay!
Premise is still holding. All right, cool. Well, that wraps us up. I've been BT Calloway. That's Elliot J. O'Neill.
Later.
You can hear us on The Simpsons Index, but for now, our watch has ended.